So, whoa.
Hey, weird people.
Yeah, so what did you think of the Drake album? Good, bad, indifferent? Your thoughts and more on Weird Things.
Hey, so I just accidentally hit Control V, so that meant some slice of me from the past that needed to come out was still in cache, and I didn't know, I don't know when I said this or what, but I just controlled V'd, and what came out was, you know, you're always worried, like, am I, you know, do I want to know what I was pasted in before? Turns out I pasted, that's okay, I think you're great, which might be my favorite thing. That I think that belongs, like, permanently. That's all I can control V from now on.
I mean, that's okay. I think you're great.
What? You disagree?
No.
What's this?
That's okay. I think you're great.
There's an earthquake happening over here. Ah! Are you guys even gonna go see the new Independence Day movie?
I like the first one.
Oh, yeah. Wait. Are we at odds on whether or not Independence Day is a fun movie?
I watched it in the movie theater, and it's really hard to get excited about it when, as you're walking out, somebody's like, it's like Star Wars for our generation. And I'm like, no, you idiot. Star Wars is Star Wars for our generation.
Right,
you know?
Can't let some random idiot ruin it for you like that.
I mean, sure. And maybe
hey,
I was
Brian,
just burdened by knowing.
Star Wars is like Independence Day for our generation.
Sure.
Did I ruin Star Wars for you? Did I?
No. But, you know, while we're at it, maybe it was just that I knew a little bit too much about what it took to create a network and for me to buy their Skull and Crossbones MacBook.
Wait, hold on. That's all right. So can we get into that criticism of the movie? That's where it falls apart. Not the aliens, not Welcome to Earth, not like the telepathy. Like that's where, which granted, silly, like gigantic suspension of disbelief, silly, right? But none of the other weird alien stuff.
Well, the other parts are all in the black box. I have no experience with telepathy. I have no experience with international politics. I have no experience with commanding giant swaths of military. I have experience about trying to get two computers to talk to each other, and I don't think they talk to each other as easy as they're represented in that movie.
With strip clubs. And Vivica A. Fox's residency does not seem like what is consistent to me with a strip club.
Well, if
she
that
does live in an exceptionally expensive house in the movie. Brian, having watched Independence Day quite recently, I can point out it was said in the film that they did have the alien ship there for like 60 years and had been trying to figure it out. So the idea that they could have come up with some sort of interface controller.
And I eventually did my best to massage my way into being okay with it. And that's kind of where I ended up with, too.
Yeah.
But
I look at it like Armageddon. Armageddon is a movie that conceptually they said, oh, yeah, we want these rockets to be impossible. We know titanium's not a material used for spacecraft, but we love the sound of it. It was a cartoon. They said they're making a cartoon. And that's why, like, Armageddon. I love Armageddon.
Armageddon is a piece of shit script, and the person who wrote it will never amount to anything.
Okay, all right. Look, checkmate, of course. I'm a bad person because I'm the only one who hated Armageddon, and I definitely rented it from Blockbuster
and
returned it.
You and Phil played hate Armageddon.
Oh, by the way, no. And actually, Brian, this I feel like is a part of it. Because Independence Day, I saw when it was 96, so I was 13. It was right in my wheelhouse. It was like me and my friends were all like counting down ID4. We knew exactly when we were going to go see it. Like it was like a big event. We saw it. We loved it. We thought it was the best thing ever. And then just in those intervening years, Armageddon comes out. When?
2002?
All the cynicism of my teenage years had climbed in, and now I wasn't just a fresh-faced 13-year-old looking to go to the theater and be excited with my friends. It was, oh, man, film. Look at what an insult to movies Armageddon is and was. Like, so my feelings for Armageddon, although I do think that they are both similar movies that want to do similar things, I was on both sides of that coin. I was fresh-faced, amazing Star Wars for my generation, 13-year-old, youth, and then a jaded, what, 15 or 16 year old judging, you know, all like, well, because I knew everything about movies.
It had to be part of it that because I actually enjoyed watching Independence Day at the time. And, you know, people were a bit hyperbolic in their responses to it. And I was kind of rolling my eyes. I was like, okay, guys, it's not high art. This was a utterly ridiculous popcorn movie. And it was really funny at times. But I wonder if Armageddon suffered, and I'm going to use suffered in the vaguest of air quotes, given the fact that it made all the money in the world and was the far more financially successful of the two. But I wonder if artistically it suffered by virtue of debuting within minutes of a far more thoughtful, studied iteration of the same idea, right?
Have you seen Deep Impact recently? Have you watched that movie?
I watched both of them. I mean, I watched Deep Impact all the way through, unlike Armageddon the first time. It took me
a
second
time.
So
we cut to Taye Leone talking to her mom about her father's divorce and the new wife. And then we cut to a scene where we're watching them discuss this thing, and she... It's a crappy movie. It is not a good movie. It is a movie that...
Granted, I will cede all of that. At no point was it an insulting movie. At no point was I like, I am insulted that you think I would buy this, which I felt every 5 seconds.
They shoot like the bat cables into the...
They're trying to do their stuff, and you look at that, and there's just as many... Oh, there's no gravity. Oh, we got gravity. Oh, there's no gravity. We got gravity. Oh, we're flying. Oh, it's like, wait, it's a lot of inconsistencies there, and it's not fun. Armageddon is not saying like tonight from Nova Armageddon. It's like, hey, let's just have a fun movie.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, we could have it out. In fact, maybe that would be a good weird thing special is we all watch the two side by side because I mean, like the moment that I was just angry that they were feeding this to the international public. The idea that you take two space shuttles, you spin them in a circle around Mir, and suddenly Mir has gravity and icicles that go down perpendicular to the spin.
We do like Brian watch The Hobbit and like get your reaction to that.
Okay, but again, The Hobbit doesn't say, I'm a scientist and I've studied Hobbit science and I've proven to
you. I'm telling Brian, the producers of Armageddon were like, we're making a cartoon, guys. This is a Wile E. Coyote cartoon. They were very open about that, but you don't want to acknowledge that they're telling you, no, we're going to make a cartoon level movie.
That's fine, but you could get there if you inoculate people. And I've used this example before. Men in Black did that. Men in Black got me in the cartoon mindset immediately. Armageddon never has that moment of inoculation.
Understood.
Like the part where the meteor hits a Godzilla stand because they were going to compete with Godzilla.
I mean, that was an inside wink. That's hard. That's far from... You know, it's like show me some rubber physics early on. Whatever. I maintain my unfair position that if I don't go along for the ride, it's the fault of the director, not my fault as the viewer.
Brian, I mean, there's only one arbitrator of what is a good movie for Brian Brushwood, and that's Justin.
Yes, he'll tell me whether or not I enjoyed it.
Sir, but like, it can be like it's like music or something like that. Be like, nah, it's not my. It's just techno music, just a lot of droning beats. And be like, that's.
Well, I have an expert for that. Then I have Bryce tell me whether or not I enjoyed it.
Yeah, and so like Brian, like yeah, I'm not. You're Brian. You're not wrong. You don't like it. As much as I want to tell you, you're wrong.
It's fine.
Yeah, I think
listen, as somebody who's had this argument with Andrew probably 30 times about Armageddon versus Deep Impact, let me just let you know, we can just fast forward to the end. This is far more about Andrew being annoyed that people like Deep Impact than it is about his defense of Armageddon. Like,
I think you know what? That's fair enough, because I think a big part of why I loved Deep Impact was I was like, can't believe the balls on this movie trying to sell this like very bleak vision of just barely surviving in a mass audience like that. It just seems so punk rock for them to go.
I guess,
that.
But that's the thing is, I think, and I'm speaking for Andrew because I'm the arbitrator of Andrew's arguments. I think part of it is that less people really remember Deep Impact. It was a less seen movie. It is a less remembered movie, and ultimately, it is just the shadow of Armageddon that we remember Deep Impact. In the way that we do, and it's not just a flick that came and went.
I hope you're looking at the comments here, because our comments have made some very interesting comments about Deep Impact.
Yes. It turns out they all think that Vice Versa was a better movie than Like Father, Like Son. That's the real debate we need to be having here.
You know, one of my favorite parts about Armageddon, though, was the opening with the Charlton Heston. It happened before, and it will happen again. I'm like, yes, bring that asteroid.
Yeah, you know, well, that was also so... It was that Armageddon, Deep Impact, and then, like, was it the next summer or the summer after that it was Dante's Peak and Volcano that there was just, like, this big, like a wiener measuring contest between studios of who could do the exact same script?
Yeah, and it was interesting because Volcano was the bigger, but Dante's Peak was kind of fun. You know, Volcano had to have the relationship of a potential love interest of Tommy Lee Jones and Anne Heche, which made it...
Makes sense. A little.
If you had a problem with the science of Armageddon.
A little bit of a, you know, it's a May 2053 romance.
Oh, no,
that was the year before Dante's Peak and Volcano. And then the next year was Armageddon and Deep Impact. 97 was Volcano and Dante's Peak, and then 98... was Armageddon Deep Impact.
90s was like such a like F you, like you do your movie, we'll put R into production faster, you know.
Well, and that's what, and Andrew, I think you were the one to tell me this, but I don't know where it came from, but the whole Steven Spielberg Lost World thing. Where...
Oh, yeah, maybe a dinosaur expert who worked on the film told me this.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Can we share this apocryphal rumor?
Yeah, if you look at Lost World, and you look at, there are several scenes in there, you're like, well, that's sort of weird and interesting. So the T-Rex chasing people down the street. There is a boat crashing into a dock. And I'm trying to figure out what else there was. But that was the big movies that there, that movie that summer was coming out was Speed 2 Cruise Control, which the big set piece was going to be a boat crashing into the dock. So Spielberg was like, we need to have a bigger boat crashing into a bigger dock. And then with Godzilla, he's like, let's do our own monster running out, Godzilla chasing people. That's why literally in Lost World, like, wow, there's Asian people there. That feels a little bit awkward, you know, that he's doing it like that, you know, and that's what that was. And so it was very much a, I'm going to do it bigger.
Yeah, it really was like eight dudes in Hollywood that were just like, you know, taking, you know, gigantic shots at each other while the world clapped along.
Yeah. All right, gentlemen. All right, ready?
Ready. Hold on, I gotta swallow my gum.
Yeah, hold on 1 second. There we go. We got Showbot going.
What's the one urban legend that you held on to the longest and you were most embarrassed to realize you were still bought at the oldest age?
I had a conversation once with one of the, when I worked for Penn & Teller, a guy that worked for them, and so this was a long time ago, and I mentioned, you know, I mentioned something like, oh, yeah, I heard of this, and this is before, like, Snopes or whatever. I mentioned something, it's like, nope, urban legend. I'm like, oh, well, this girl who was a hairdresser and, you know, hit a guy on the side of the head with the air dryer because he was playing with himself or whatever. It's like, nope, that's never happened either. And I started naming a couple of them, like, yeah, I got no stories then. I got no interesting things to tell you.
What about you, Justin? Was there a moment?
I'm sure if we talked about it, I could think of one, but there's not any, like, off the top that I know I would just be...
Your story about the dude in the throne and the abandoned building thing.
Oh yeah. Oh no, that was definitely like, yeah, that was like local neighborhood legend. But that's one of those things where it's like you just get older and you realize like, oh wow, that's ridiculous. There's no way that could possibly happen. But when you're a kid, you're like, yeah, I mean, it's outside of our neighborhood. Literally anything's possible.
I know for me, it was just the general idea that any of my memories were true. And I didn't find it out until I was 27 years old researching for the lecture right around the time I met you guys, Scam Sasquatch of the Supernatural. And I just that flat scientific confirmation that not only do you not remember everything, but all the things you think you remember are wrong. It was
it's weird because, Brian, like, I never had a problem with that because I always had such a crappy memory. I always had such a poor memory.
And I always did. And again, you only compare against your mom or your dad or your brother or whatever. And it's like I was always able to do better at them at remembering stuff. So I just assumed anytime there was a conflict that I'm like, well, they're dumb and I'm awesome. And there are just people who have wrong memories, but not me. But then, like, at the age of a quarter century, finding out that that's all very, very wrong, I was like, ooh.
Okay, we are ready to go, guys.
Oh, yeah.
Take it away in 3, 2.
Hello and welcome to the Weird Things Podcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Justin Robert Young.
Hi, friends. It's me.
And Brian Brushwood.
I'd tell you I wasn't here, but I'm too honest for that.
That's what we call him, Brian Honest Brian. Brushwood.
He'll tell you if he's really here.
That's my entire platform. I'm going to go for president. That's the one thing. A lot of people up here on this platform, they'll tell you anything. I'm only going to tell you one thing. I'm here.
It's the Descartes platform.
That's right.
Boys and girls, let's jump right into a question. All right. And this is going to be for Brian. Maybe a scenario, Brian. Would you like a scenario?
Yeah, man. I feel like we got off that scenario train. I'm ready to get back. Now that finally SpaceX has taken over the world, we can get back to the real questions that matter.
Right. So, Brian, imagine that you go get some 23andMe kits to do DNA testing for the family, and you want to surprise them with a family tree, right?
Which, by the way, I guess nowadays 23andMe can't make any specific claims about how likely you are to get different diseases. They have to be entirely we're not giving medical advice. We're just, you know, we're just telling you about your ancestry.
No, actually, they've come to some agreements with the FDA, so that's changed a little bit. But anyhow, they can do a little bit more, but they've trying to work with the FDA to give you some more helpful information. But you get the kits, you go around and you swab Bonnie. You have, 8 children now?
Yep.
All right. You swab, let's say 3 of the kids. You give them all little swabs, put them in the little container, seal it back up. Send it off to the labs, and then a couple weeks later, you
kinda
get some envelopes in the mail.
Kind
of
want to do this.
Results are
right
here. Now, Bonnie and your children are off on a trip, and you're like, let's go take a look here. Let's go take a look at their little DNA profiles. Let's see what we have, what we inherited, where we come from. And you pull up your profile, you find out your quarter Cherokee, as we predicted. Find out, you know, Bonnie's ancestry, and then you look at the oldest one, Juniper. You know, she's like, you know, both traits really strong, and then Cadence, the second one, and then who's the youngest one?
Tripoli.
Okay, yeah. Tripoli, and you pull up Tripoli. Oh, this is interesting. It's just Northern European, but no Brian traits and no Bonnie traits at all.
Now, when you say no Brian traits, you mean like by the numbers, this is a Bonnie and.
No, I didn't. Oh, notice I said no Bonnie or Brian or Bonnie, but you immediately assumed that she'd been stepping out on you. Interesting.
She said no. Oh, so no Brian or Bonnie traits.
No
at
Brian
all?
Or Bonnie.
Oh, no, geez. Even in a gigantic scientific anomaly, it has to be slut-shaming.
No. The reason is because we've talked before about the existence of chimeras. There are mothers.
Nope, neither you nor Bronny.
Okay, right. That's that. Okay, now we're getting to it. We're talking about a medical mix-up as a kid? A baby swap?
It would be the likely explanation.
Can I tell you when I know that they go through an extraordinary amount of double checking and protecting everything. They make sure to put on wristbands and they take blood the moment the baby's born, right there when it's in front of you. On my third daughter, I remember thinking like, man, they just all look the same as babies, don't they? And then I went to go visit in the lineup of other babies, and I realized, They don't all look the same. Just all my children look exactly the same because there's something about my Frankenstein-like brow that is very prominent on all three of our infant children. And it was like, it was amazing because you worry about a mix-up, and then I walked up and down and I was just like, no need for a DNA test. I'm pretty sure we got the right animal here.
But you don't in this situation. You're looking at the results, and you see clearly that Tripoli is not your child.
So the other two are. The other two have.
Other two are.
I mean, first of all, there has to be precedence from history of exactly this, where maybe one person, if not the other party, knows that. That this is not the child. I think I would do what all of them have done, which is I'd shut my mouth for the rest of my life. I'd burn the results. I mean, what's there to be gained?
So you wouldn't tell Bonnie?
I don't think I would. Because it's Bonnie who would take it harder than me.
Wow, that's a big call, though. And I don't criticize you for making it because you of the only the three people that are on here know the politics of not only husband wife but also mother father, like, but that's huge, right? Like to keep that from her.
Now let me put it this way. I'm not gonna say I wouldn't tell her forever, but I would press pause while I could do a little bit of research, maybe hire a private investigator, do some poking around if I can.
All right, here. My name is Guy Findthings. I am a private investigator here in Austin, Texas, of the Colombian Findthings. Anyway, what do you want me to find?
Listen, there's a kid that we thought it was our own. We thought we had it downtown, somewhere around 34th Street. Maybe a little switcheroo happened. Any chance you could find out, what other kids were born around the same time? And if any of them maybe have, checked out 23andMe and maybe are our biological child? And then, so here's the worst part, right?
Yeah.
Is I would wait to tell Bonnie... based on the results, because if the results come back, they're all like, well, there's only one other kid that it could possibly be, and a meteor smashed into their ambulance on the way home. They're all dead.
Well, Brian, that's the second part I want to get to. So you've established that you would not tell Bonnie.
I mean, I would get around to telling Bonnie. I just don't know that I'd kick in the door right now. Yeah.
Anyway, I'm your private investigator, Guy Findthings. Turns out I'm going to need to take a little sabbatical on this. I'm going to be gone for another 12 years. But don't worry. Thorough finding of things takes some time. The truth is worth waiting. See you later.
Well, so you say eventually you get around to telling Bonnie, but that's the thing, is the question is going to be in your mind is first it's going to, because you think, oh, not my child, but this child is clearly my child. Then you'll start to think, wait, I do have another child out there.
Well, and plus, here's the weird thing. At what age, let's say you're at 4 years old, or Calliope is 3 years old, 3.5 now. I would say that if I just met another family in Austin that showed up and were like, hi, we just found out definitively that that's our baby and we have your baby. They're real different and personalities are really different or whatever. Like, and they say, we don't really care one way or the other. We're just glad both of these little girls are healthy. Do you want to trade back or are you happy with the one you got? I gotta tell you, I think I might be all like, I'm fine. I like Callie a lot.
You have to say that you don't want to trade. For sake.
But, all right, here, Brian, your phone's ringing.
Ring. Sorry, Jeff. Hello, this is Brian.
Hey, it's me, Guy Findthings. Anyway, I'm here in Mexico. I'm not going to lie to you. I'm pretty wasted. But I was just thinking that you still haven't told your wife, right?
I've talked about it in the hypothetical, but no, I mean, is there something I should share with her?
No, I was just thinking kind of really weird if, like, your biological kid's out there and needs a specific blood type or an organ or something like that, and you're not around to do it. That's a real effed up situation. Anyway, check, please. I'll talk to you later. I'm still on the case.
Guy finds things.
What if you, like, so would you hire Guy Finesworth things to find your other child?
Yeah, I guess I would.
All right. Have you told Bonnie yet, or are you trying to do this before you tell Bonnie?
No, at this point, once it occurs to me that there's a biological reason that I should track down my offspring so that I could be available for genetic contributions and stuff, yes, yeah, absolutely. Bonnie's full in on that.
All right. Do you? What if you find out this
child
has
it? By the way, time out. That smile and nod is what happens right before the jaws snap shut, and I hear checkmate from over my shoulder.
Exactly. No. I'm trying to imagine that I Guy Finesworth. Could you find Bonnie and put Bonnie on the phone? Because I want to hear this conversation where Brian tells her, one, that he knows this, two, how long he's known this, and then explains the conditions their real child is living in.
Let me try. Okay, well, what conditions is my real child in?
Poor, father's in jail, mother is a stripper dating a pilot who died testing alien spacecraft.
You're describing the plot to Independence Day.
Maybe.
All right.
Oh, my God. If this is deep marketing, I'm going to be so...
I'm going to see if I can call Bonnie. I think she's actually at one of our children's recitals.
Right? Oh, God. He's actually going to get his wife on
first,
the phone.
First, you're getting a call. Hey, it's me, Guy Finethings. Turns out I found your kid. The father's in jail. The mother's a stripper that is dating a pilot who just died literally seconds ago. I'm here. I'm looking at his corpse, tasting an alien spacecraft. I said tasting, not testing. It's not really weird. It started as a test. It ended as a taste. Bada bing, bang, boom. Boyfriend's dead. Kids around. I'll bill ya. Find things out.
Turns out there's two major brands of spacecraft, and they want to know which one tastes better. And so he participated in the alien spacecraft
the
tasting.
Game for heroin. Here in Columbia, South Carolina.
Yeah. All right. I'm just going to give a little call to Bonnie. We'll just see. What's the exact question?
The exact question is, how are you going to broach the whole, hey, our child's not our child?
Hey, Bon. Bonnie, are you live at an event?
Live at an event?
Wait, is this Josie? Josie.
Weird.
Josie, how did you answer the phone?
No, you. This is my phone.
No, I called your mom.
No, you're on my phone.
Okay, listen, Josie, I'm just going to have to ask you, kiddo. I want you to imagine that we found out that one of your sisters is not actually your sister. And in fact, we accidentally took home the wrong baby. And we found out that your actual sister is somewhere else. Should we tell Mom?
Yes.
Well, what did we tell her?
You got the wrong baby.
Okay, but let's say it's Penny. You're just gonna tell Penny get out of here?
I'd say Shoo!
Skedaddle. All right. Thank you, sweetheart. Bye.
Yeah, I was gonna say at their ages, that might be a feature, not a bug.
Shoo! Skedaddle.
Brian leaves the results on the table and he walks upstairs and Josie's already packing Calliope's
thing. No. He said. He said Penny. That in one political move, middle child becomes the most tenured daughter in the household. That is some House of Cards level maneuvering.
All right, tell me this actually happened. Tell me there's some historical basis for this.
I mean, there's a lot of historical basis for this, Brian. I mean, it's a, and it's one of the things that's happening, you know, more and more. And it's, you know, more of just sort of a theoretical question is that one of the things that we've kind of, we used to talk a lot is the whole idea of the ethical implications of what happens when you're dealing with these situations as we start dealing with cloning, doing that. But you looked at, you know, you look at for news, you know, items on Switched at Birth, and you find out there are a lot of these situations, you know, and it still happens. And there was an article in Chicago Tribune that came out just a couple weeks ago that talked about that it's happens, you know, it's some of these things that just, you know, still happens a you know, number of times. And you're also getting, too, is that as we're doing more in vitro fertilization, mix-ups occur in clinics, you know?
Oh, my gosh. You're talking about, daddy's like, before anybody's even born, before the embryo is even implanted, you know, sample 27-2AB is replaced with sample 27-alpha-7-3.
Well, I mean, you have to figure that these are offices like anything else that have mix-ups, right, that have mistakes, clerical errors. But this is like this feels like the every conspiracy movie, every spy movie ever, where the intrepid reporter has to figure out, or a member of the cabinet has to figure out why everybody's covering something up, and it's because a mistake was made that is too important to go back on. Like, and that's got to happen all the time, right?
So here's an example of two French families whose babies were switched at birth at 20 decide to remain estranged after a heartbreaking reunion.
Oh, this is what I was afraid of. Talk me through it.
According to interviews, at the time, the babies had been switched at birth by a drunk nurse who was suffering from depression.
Oh.
Now, understand, like today, they go through, have all sorts of protocols to prevent this from happening, right?
Sure.
You know, and so it's, yeah, I mean, it's just, they, at some point, I don't know when the reunion tried to happen, but it just did not work. Anyhow, let me just pull that up and read it. So it's not
kind of. Well, I mean, so what happened? They went to go reunite, and they were like, "Wow, I deeply dislike you, and I'm not happy that we're related."
Basically. So I mean, it happened. I mean, medical sort of acts, you know, switches because one girl had jaundice, whatever. But anyhow, the girls were put together in one incubator, and then you know they separated. There was a lawsuit. Money was exchanged. And you know, trying to meet with the sort of the birth mothers and all that didn't work very well. But you know, point is that.
Well, I mean, I guess that's the problem is that in the hypothetical, you may encounter when you picture the other family, whatever the other family is, you picture them as versions of yourself. The reality, of course, is that you encounter very different people.
Yeah, and like in this case, was like this one woman. You know, she refuses to see her biological child because she's happy with the child she has. She's like, well, you know, worked out well enough. I'm happy. And I don't want to maybe, you know, it's a difficult situation because you don't want to create a bond with, you know, somebody else later on. And so anyhow, this was on a TLC program.
I mean, in the perfect version is, you know, you establish a deeper community bond between the two families, but
yeah.
You can't necessarily decide that.
No, you cannot.
That's heartbreaking though. I mean, like, especially because this is there's so much that goes into it that even like taking a meeting with a biological family, although understood probably by all parties rationally, is still ultimately going to kind of look like some level of rejection, right?
Yep. Speaking of rejection and not wanting to have us be separated.
Yeah. Hey, if you want to not make an accidental separation of this show from happening, then you can go ahead and head on over to patreon.com.
I mean, you know, Justin, let's not whitewash this. Let's talk to the people directly and treat them like adults.
And treat them right.
As of today, I don't think we've ever announced this on the show. I know some people had thought otherwise, but we can firmly say that Andrew Main, Justin Young, Brian Brushwood,
yeah,
all three of us are not genetically related. We are not biologically related. We're not family members. We are It turns out we are torn asunder in three different tribes, and the only thing that brings us together every Sunday is your affection and your love. People say, how can you make your affection felt? Well, turns out there's a website, patreon.com. Patreon, from the Greek patrios, which means showing your love.
Through money.
And weird things.
Through weird
Latin
things.
Latin word things. Wherein three men engage in a combat of the mind. Listen, folks, it doesn't take Guy Find Things to direct you right where you need to go. Patreon.com/weirdthings.
Absolutely. Throw us whatever you think the show's worth.
Also, go look at that video where my beard is clearly far larger than my forehead, and it looks really odd.
Okay, you're looking at, if I was squinting, one third of your face is hat, one third of your face is flesh, and one third of your face is beard.
It's a very weird, like, if you turned my face upside down, it would look like Kramer.
Except for that part that you lean back, then it was like all beard. That was crazy.
Then it comes at you, and luckily we're not in 3D.
Gentlemen, I got more.
Heck yeah, let's dive in, man.
Samal.
It's not good, guys. It's not good.
What do you mean? How bad can it be? That's our tagline for Weird Things.
Brian, if I were to ask you, how many BFFs do you have? How many best friends do you have? What would the answer be?
Two, three, if you want to include my wife. Four, if you want to include our producer, Bryce. Five, if you want to include Tom Merritt. So, yeah, maybe six, seven, eight. I have eight.
Sub ten.
Are we count my kids? My kids?
No, I mean like best friend. We don't have to include family.
Oh. Then none. I'm my own man.
What?
No, I would say
that was an audible what from Bryce, the producer.
I'm gonna say like there's family aside, I'd say there's seven people that I truly feel like are all my besties.
Justin? And I know I'm your BFFF.
Of course. Yeah. I probably got, there's Guy Fine Things.
Image of Justin with a deerskin hat and a cigar.
I don't know, a tight five. I would say probably a fiver.
A tight five.
Yeah.
Interesting. Well, researchers, including Robin Dunbar, who we know came up with a Dunbar number, explaining like how many kind of a relationships you can have, said they've done the crunch of the numbers, they've looked at it, figured out, you know, what the realistic number is that people actually have for the total number of BFFs that you can have. And anybody over this number is just a dirty liar.
Damn it.
Probably isn't close. Maybe a sociopath. This is going to be my letter to the editor assessment.
It's certainly not projecting.
No, not at all. Anybody want to guess what that number is?
Probably two.
Anybody else?
What does she describe as best friend? What is best friend?
Robin's a he, but...
What does he describe?
It's a group of researchers, actually, but they would just say that, you know, these are people you spend the... Like, if you looked at, like, how people you talk to the most, and you put, like, who do you choose to talk to or whatever, and, like, who really stands out on that graph? How many really, really... Because they're like, oh, yeah, my best friend. When's the last time you hung out with them or talked to them?
That does change things. It's tough to make that a personal thing because, you know, we have these podcasts where we, you know, decide to see each other once a week. So it's like, you know, you're in the group, Justin, you're in the group, Andrew.
I'm just in a group now, Brian. Thank you.
Well, I mean, you're one of the BFFs. You're in the BFF club. What better club would you be in?
I would say that oddly, or maybe not oddly, the fact that we do this show, that we have this time where we are always talking to each other in front of people leads me to talk to you guys more, you know?
That's right. The only reason you talk to us?
No.
Brian, are you hearing
this? I'm saying that it's more so than other people that I would like to keep in touch with that I don't keep in touch with.
Right, for example.
People he likes more than us, Brian? Are you hearing this?
Okay, so for example, one
you
of...
You are rapidly talking your way out of my file.
Oh, is that how easy it is?
So, you guys are familiar with the incredible magician Nate Staniforth, who I've known for over a decade now. We were represented by the same folks in the college market. I've watched him go on to host Discovery Television shows. He's now doing a tour across the United States, and he's in this weird clubhouse where maybe once every 3 weeks, either I'll call him or he'll call me. And it's as though no matter what, no matter where either one of us are, it's pretty much we know the next 90 minutes are going to be spent dropping everything and getting caught up with each other. You know, I consider him one of my best friends in all of Magic. But if you define best friendship as the amount of time that you spend with someone, that certainly alters it, especially if you're talking about physical proximity as opposed to, you know, emotional communicative proximity. Because for an awful long time, the first, 5 years of my friendship with both of you guys, I saw you in person maybe 7 times.
Yeah.
So I will say, if we are defining it based on current contact, then I probably have 2, and they're on this show. I probably talk to the two of you guys more than anyone else on a regular basis. So I would say that there are other people for whom I can catch up with really, really quickly, and that there is an emotional intimacy. But if we are judging it by constant contact, I would say 2.
Yeah. All right. I'm on the same page.
Wait, Bryce and Brian, or me and Bryce? What they did is they grouped this, and the number they came up with, they said they started the Dunbar number, and it's 150 people. It's a number of people you can have kind of the meaningful relationships with. And some people can do more than that. Master networkers, people who are exceptionally contact. A lot of people are really successful in business and politics often are incredible networkers who can keep track of multiple people. I walk into a party, and if there are 3 people there, I'm lucky if I can remember one name, and that's my own. But they take that 150 sort of the median. 150 people is the average number of people that we can have casual conversations with, feel pretty relaxed with on a regular basis. Breaking that down, they said there are 5 of those people make up your closest friends. 5 of those people make up your closest friends, followed by 10 for the next layer. 10 is the next layer, like, oh, yeah, it's cool. I hang out, talk to this person, whatever. 35 in the third level, and then 100 in the outermost.
It seems right that there are different orbits. Unfortunately, as scientific as we want to couch this whole thing, as important as it is anthropologically, I mean, at some level, we're having that MySpace conversation of you know, who's in my top 8, you know?
Well, the way they did that was they would look at phone calls and look at phone call frequencies. You know, so it's an interesting way to do that. And by the way, I got to meet the guy last night who created the MySpace worm that made everybody follow him.
Oh, wait, who is that?
Sammy. It was this weird party where you meet everybody by their first name and then you totally forget their last name. I'll give you
Sammy JS Space Hero.
Yes.
By Sammy Camcar.
Yes, that's Sammy Camcar. So, you know, he created the worm that made everybody follow him and he got arrested.
How did he get arrested?
Because he created a worm that infected the MySpace servers.
I mean,
the fastest spreading virus of all time.
Hmm. All right.
Yeah, I mean, dude, hit with a felony charge.
Yeah, I mean, like, yeah, sure, let's put him in a cage with rapists. That makes sense.
He was the guy that I don't think he actually was in a cage with rapists, unless it was probation. A voluntary thing. But he also, which I don't think it would be, he was also the one that figured out that, like, how Visa and all the other ones were using RFID to track us. He's found a number of exploits and stuff that even ties into the Snowden stuff. So, he's a board of directors, Brave New Software, nonprofit that helps look for, you know, different kinds of exploits and hacks and to try to go after oppressive regimes and things like that, you know, show if you're being monitored. So neat guy. But anyhow.
But also a terrible criminal. Shame on him.
I don't know.
No, I mean, it's his event that, you know, he had the White House chief of technology, you know, was having great conversation with him because he's like, we need to figure out how to use this guy's knowledge base to help our country and help the world. So, you know, he's a very interesting guy. But anyhow, he was the one that found out that the PHP pseudo-random number generator was, like, very predictable, and that was, like, made it available for PhD, you know, hacking, which he actually created a patch for. So he's a very good white hat hacker now. Very, very good. He would be in the Avengers, right? Anyhow, gentlemen. One more topic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, we get a lot of grief sometimes from a small segment of this audience that gets frustrated at how much we talk about Elon Musk and SpaceX. But it's
yeah,
like,
by the way, and I don't feel bad about outing where that criticism comes from. Elon Musk, face it, you're a hell of a guy, and we're going to talk about you. So stop responding with all these critical emails, all right?
Yeah. Guys, please just let me work in quiet. SpaceX made an announcement this week. Pretty big, bold announcement here. Brian, you saw this, right?
I don't think I did. Maybe.
SpaceX said 2018, right? 2018. If you go get a two-year calendar later this year, it'll have 2018 on there. We can talk about defined 2018 and what Star Wars films and Marvel movies are going to come out there. Well, SpaceX is going to take a Falcon rocket, a Falcon Heavy rocket, and they're going to send one of their Dragon spacecraft to Mars.
Okay.
It will be the largest thing to ever land on Mars. It's going to have to, it's going to do retro rockets to land on the surface of Mars. It's going to weigh something like 9,000 pounds. We don't know what equipments are in there. By the way, we don't know if this mission is supposed to be in it, but this rocket is actually capable, the capsule is actually capable of taking off from Mars too and doing a payload return to Earth called a mission called Red Dragon.
So what do you think their best bet is? Do you put, do you send a message about the colonization of Mars by sending one-way goods that will be valuable to future missions? Do you send a rover that sounds like every other, you know, NASA mission to go get samples or whatever?
You send science. You don't waste it to send some, you know, Amazon Prime granola bars that, you
No. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is imagine, you know, you send something over there and it pops open and a pop tent comes out and it starts growing you know, algae in there. Like that would be astonishingly valuable.
It'll have experiments for colonization of Mars. It'll absolutely have research and experiments to figure out how they want to colonize and what they want to do there. It's definitely going to have that kind of stuff. What it's going to be yet, we don't know. They're still probably determining that, but they're going to send, and that the capsule that's going to land on Mars is the same, you know, sized one that they'll be using to put astronauts on the International Space Station. Theoretically, if you could fit inside of there and fit your food and all of everything to recycle what you need, it would be a human-capable craft. It'd be a ridiculously small space and take forever. But the point is, this is the largest payload we've ever sent to Mars, be the largest thing to ever land on Mars. In 2018 is when the mission launches, which if they hit the six-month window, it could land in like 2018.
I mean, okay, so let's say, and here's part of the reason, I know you're rolling your eyes at granola bars, but let's say that somebody was just crazy enough to plan on 10, 15 years from now landing on Mars and staying there forever. Somebody who, I don't know, maybe his stated goal is to die on Mars. It seems like 2018 would be a good time to start sending, I don't know, granola bars out if Elon Musk plans to head on out around that
because
time.
He's going to be using, they're coming up with the next generation of heavier lift vehicles that will have far, far more cargo capacity. And if you could, if that granola bar could instead be an algae experiment, you know, to figure out what you can grow on Mars, that would be the way to do it. I mean, he's trying to build a sustainable thing on Mars. So I think personally, I think it'd be premature to start trying to send supplies when you want to be sending science packages to figure out what you're going to need, how you're going to live there, because he's building a whole architecture of spacecraft that we'll find out in September for colonizing Mars.
I mean, it seems like, wouldn't it be great if he's like, hey, look at us, first private company to ever send anything to Mars. Crazy, right? Second time, we're going to do it. Where are we going to land? Same place as the first. I mean, it seemed pretty interesting. Still a lot more science to do there. Third, fourth, fifth, sixth time. And they're like, looks an awful lot like, are you building a city on Mars? And you're like, we're just throwing a lot of private probes onto Mars. I mean,
I don't think he's hiding his intentions. And like I said, in September,
he'd be passing out real estate pamphlets. Yeah. By the way, also, welcome here for our timeshare seminar.
Yeah. So what we have, it's exciting missions. So they're doing an agreement with NASA, which is what they call a non-cost technology transfer, meaning, you know, NASA's not giving them any money, and they're not giving NASA any money, but to share data about landing on Mars. So they're working, and they're trying really hard to work with, you know, NASA, and I'm sure that we're going to be finding there's going to be more announcements as far as what kind of experiments are going to go on there. If you look at you know, the scale of what this is. This is to figure out, you know, how to land people on Mars is a challenge. And that's clearly, they said, yes, no, this is because we want to colonize Mars and we want to start getting more research. But 2018, that's Brian. That's when your colonization begins. That's when the invasion begins.
Dude, it's happening in our lifetime. The future is delivering so hard on all the promises that I hoped when I was 8 years old. I'm so happy.
So, I guess, and this is always my fascination with this, because I'm always so interested about, like, the narrative and how that affects expectations and how that affects where, you know, things go and how much humanity wants to get excited or focus on it and how that affects the process itself. When does this become the biggest story on the planet? Because it has to eventually, right? If they continue, if SpaceX continues to deliver on the level that they have at the rate that they have.
The moment you transition to pilgrims, it becomes speculative, crazy, highfalutin, rich people throwing rocks.
The biggest thing before that, because the speculation of a mission is the biggest story in the history of humanity, right?
I think we're going to see, a couple weeks ago, I went to the Yuri's Night Party, which I mentioned, you know, at the California Science Center. These things, space stuff is getting more and more popular. More and more people are showing up to go do these things, okay? Space startups, there's more of these. When SpaceX tries to launch the Falcon Heavy, hopefully in November, which will be the largest rocket since the Saturn V, when that takes off, which may even have more thrust. I mean, SpaceX just, by the way, upped the amount of thrust that all the rockets have. They said, oh, we can push our engines even more. When Falcon Heavy launches, that's going to be huge. That's going to be the most, my prediction is going to be the most attended launch since probably the last shuttle launch, and may even exceed that, because of just the growing awareness and excitement for SpaceX and to see something like that do that. The 2018, the first Mars launch for this. Now we have other Mars projects from NASA that have taken off that are attended, but I think for a Falcon Heavy sending, you know, it's an unmanned, but sending a large craft like this to Mars, I think it's going to be extremely a popular launch, and I think it's going to build. I think that after Musk announces the architecture for the Mars Colonial Transport, which is what they call the big fracking rocket, which is going to be a huge rocket, bigger than anything ever that's taken off, which is, you know, not the Falcon Heavy, but bigger than that. When we see the first Mars Colonial Transport rocket test, which, you know, will be probably sometime in, you know, 2020 something or whatever, that's going to be insane, because you're going to see this giant behemoth of a rocket, and that's when it becomes real, because this rocket will look unlike anything we've ever seen before. And I think that's when people are like, oh man, no, this is a Mars rocket.
And that's, you know, and so great sword point something out that I think is really the crux of what I'm trying to get at, that, like, oh, I think most people just roll their eyes and blow it off. But at some point, if we continue at this level of achievement at this pace, that changes. Like, at some point, the news value becomes so great.
I hear, when I worked for, you know, the James Randi and the you know, JREF, I would hear a lot of people who were pro-science, people like, yeah, people hate science. I was like, no, I think everybody likes science. I think some people don't like scientists, or some of the people who, the way they use it or talk about it. I think a lot of people don't like arrogance. But when it comes to science and stuff like that,
well, I think people love science. They're just often ill-informed as to what that is.
And I think that, you know, you get people who are big into the F yeah science sort of thing. Like, no, that's not really science, guys. That's just putting things on your Facebook so you look smart to everybody, which I know all about.
Thank you.
I think that when I talk about rockets or space to people like that, you know, for the first 5 minutes, people are very excited, and then they drone out because, you know, I go on and on. Point is I think it's a growing thing. You know, we were, when we first started this podcast a billion years ago, we talked about SpaceX, and it was this unknown sort of startup to many people, even many of our listeners.
Yeah, you know? Even to one third of our co-hosts. There may have been, if you go back far enough and listen to the archives, an awakening, a come to Jesus moment that one of at least one third of our co-hosts have had.
Right. But once you got awareness of what's going on, and now that you have the ascendancy of Elon Musk as a public figure, and once, you know, now that they're doing, like, dude, like, the excitement for when they did the barge landing and they did the land landing for that craft, because you had people who were all of a sudden going, wait, that's a thing we can do now? You know, I think it's one of these things that you wake up one day and everybody's got animated dog faces on their video, you know, they're uploading to Twitter from Snapchat. You know, you're like, where did this come from? You know?
Yeah. Do they cover, do the 24-hour cable news networks cover, like, SpaceX launches? Like, live?
I don't think anybody's, sure, like, live, not that I'm aware of, no.
Like, I don't know. I don't know if anybody listening or watching, like, has watched coverage of space.
I mean, that's the problem, right? Is if there is a demand for that programming, that demand is already being met on the internet by everybody just going live, you know, on NASA TV.
Their next launch is going to be May 5th. It's the JSAT 4, which I think is that a weather satellite, a telecommunication satellite. So that is. They're probably going to be doing their video of it, probably showing what's going to be going on with that. Highly recommend, if you've never watched a SpaceX broadcast when they do a launch, it is amazing.
Super slick. The production is extraordinary.
You get intelligent, very, very photogenic people talking to you are all engineers and scientists, you know? It's a bunch of young people like, hey guys, let's go launch a rocket, you know? And it's you know, amazing. And it's really, they've gotten so much more professional, so much more slicker. You know, they let the SpaceX people talk about it. It's not some, you know, dilettante TV host personality. Brian, Justin, I would love to go do it for them, but they don't need us. You know, they've got a great, and it's earnest.
Can you talk about your fanboy moment?
Oh, yeah. So I'm driving to SpaceX last week, and I'm talking on the phone. I'm talking to my parents. Like, no, like I said, you know, they do great. Like, they're like, when it comes to science communication, stuff like that, as we know, is a passion for me. I'm like, I said, SpaceX does a wonderful job of it, you know, in-house. I said, you know, it's funny because you watch it and you see some dude who's like hosting it, who looks like he's some LA hired to host, you know, Entertainment Weekly show or whatever like this, you know, just, good looking dude telling you what's going on. You find out he's like a mission payload specialist or something, you know, he's an engineer. And so like, I think there's another thing, you'll see him sitting at a table in a binder, you know, but he's like, he works for SpaceX. And then I go there to go meet our buddy TJ, and I'm standing in the hallway and this dude comes walking along and I'm like, hey, you're great on your webcast. You know, he's like, thanks, it was fun. You know, like, whatever, weirdo.
That is amazing.
I do TV too.
I did it. Yeah, I was my best-selling author. There's a conversation breaker. Yo, jeez.
Security. Got another one.
Oh, that's awesome.
So yeah, they do a really, I think they do a great job of using people working at SpaceX to go do that, and it's becoming, you know, and there's exciting stuff going on, you know, and there's a lot of other little space startups and stuff that we'll probably starting to talk more about. But all the hosts. Oh my god. And by the way, have you watched the landing, the 360 degree virtual reality landing?
No, not at all. I would love to see it if they have that available.
So if you go to, it's on YouTube and you can Facebook, whatever you want to use. So Bryce is flipping through there. So you can pan around as if you're on the drone ship when the rock, look, go up, look up.
Oh,
see the little bright light.
That's great.
And then, oh my God, where's it going?
This is the most recent one. I thought the seas were a little rougher.
You can tell there's some stabilization going on.
Oh my God.
Whoa. Yeah, so you're watching, you know, like a 9-story rocket come from space and land on a barge.
I mean, a little off center, let's be honest.
Yeah. Yeah,
you know. We stopped dreaming, people.
My question is, and I actually try to see if Elon Musk sometimes goes on Twitter and answers questions. I was trying to see if he'd answer this. Does it make sense for them to buy their own aircraft carrier?
I saw that. Yeah, that's an interesting idea. Like, at what point is it cost effective to just get
used parts?
Well, like, buy an aircraft carrier so that when you're landing your cores, instead of putting on a barge, if you're, because you have with the Falcon Heavy, you have three cores. some of them going further out than the others, but you need to, you're going to have to do like sea landings on those. And so you can do multiple barges, but if you're doing daily launches, at some point, do you just like, hey, you know, let's just put an aircraft carrier out there, land them on the aircraft carrier, put them horizontal, and then when we got like 10 of them, bring it back to port.
Man, all I'm going to say is that Elon Musk has definitely not answered that question, and I'm not going to say that there needs to be a groundswell of support of people asking why he's dodging the question, but I'm just saying, you know, if carrier gate were to become a trending topic, you know, I'm just saying.
I think, listen, there's a ton of questions that we would love to ask of Elon.
Is it out of line for us to try to put together a 20-minute interview with Elon Musk at some point? Like, we could all fly. We have Patreon funds. We could all go out to L.A. I think we could do a good little interview. Is that something we should all strive for?
Yes.
Okay.
You know, I guess the question would be, you know, like, it's not like he's unavailable to media. I mean, who knows where that is, but you see,
it's not like we're not media.
So I guess we got to put on our...
we are literally the definition of friendly media. It's something that in PR you hope to find is your friendly media sources, and we are about as friendly as you get.
Yeah, we'll see.
We'll have to put on our Night Attack hats and think of a name of the campaign and see if we can't make enough noise to make that happen. That would be a blast, though.
It would probably best be waged in very, very enthusiastic emails between people.
Sure.
And waiting our turn quietly.
Sure.
Or we could just, you know. See, now I don't even want to make a joke about the hashtag.
It's all I'm thinking of is the hashtag. Yeah. Hashtag one way trip.
Hashtag I don't want to make a joke about a hashtag.
Okay.
Hey, how about picks, you guys?
Hey, man, I got a pick. I got a pick for a movie that I loved the first time I watched it, and I loved it even more the second and third time I watched it. And I had to actively trick my daughters into watching alongside with me. And man, oh, man. Is Edge of Tomorrow great? It's a really, really great movie. It's the best video game movie ever made. And news is they are a go for a sequel to Edge of Tomorrow. If you haven't seen it, you're in the perfect position if you don't even know what it's about. In that case, treat yourself by just watching it right now without learning a single thing about it. And trust me. But if not, then definitely go see Edge of Tomorrow. It had a surprising amount of joy and heart and a lot of ass kicking in there. It was great.
It is such a good movie that it's one of those things where as it got closer to release, the studio, I think, got nervous about what they had and they just bungled the marketing on it. They changed the title. I mean, the original title of the Japanese book it was based on was like Kill and Kill Again or something like that.
All you need is kill.
Yeah.
It kept changing. It's like it's one of these things where like I would sometimes stumble when I'd be like, oh, yeah, Edge of Tomorrow? Like, what's the look at the title, the post, Live, Die, Repeat, big letters. Then below that, Edge of Tomorrow. So it's like, what's title?
I think part of that.
And then they officially renamed it Live, Die, Repeat.
I don't think they ever officially renamed it. It's just that when they did the DVD release, they put the tagline far more prominently than the technical title.
Edge of Tomorrow is not on the front.
No, it is. It is. It says Live, Die, Repeat, and this is hashtag Edge of Tomorrow in the corner, very tiny. Because the headline was all saying they changed the title and they hadn't. See, there it is right there. Cruise Blunt, Edge of Tomorrow. Hold on. If you take a look at that there, DVD, boom, who was right, Brian?
They put it after Cruise and
Blunt and Edge of Tomorrow. Yes.
Sure. Yes. I mean, it's that to me would represent evidence of them changing the title.
Again, but they didn't, because to change a title changes how it's listed in registries and IMDb and stuff. But the point is, I think they were trying to, they knew there was a value. They thought, how cool would it be to watch this movie not knowing what the conceit is? And if there's a chance we can have people walk into it and discover, much to their delight, the clever mechanic of this, then we should try to make it happen. And then they realized that in doing so, they weren't putting butts in seats. And so they changed it.
Yeah, I don't know how much of its success, you know, is kind of the kind of double-edged sword of Tom Cruise right now, that, you know, he is obviously a draw, but I think that there is a bit of a fatigue to him playing a certain kind of role that this certainly looked like from the outset. What you realize when you watch it is it's such a clever script, and having the familiarity with Tom Cruise, even, you know, him doing a similar character to other characters, is almost necessary considering how complex the story gets, you know,
you need the shorthand. You need to know what he represents so that you could see within, you know, 6 seconds of this setup, you're like, oh, I get it. He's this guy doing this thing.
Yeah, and he's being cocky. He's right. Being sure. He's being clever. Like, it's like it helps you as you get through it, because he is kind of playing a bit of a stock character that you need to learn really, really quickly who he is, because how he changes is so different because of how the story unfolds. I did a whole thing with Brett where after this came out, we watched it and we were like really into it, that like, there is no end to this like Groundhog Day genre. I love, like, this is sci-fi Groundhog Day. Groundhog Day, like with Bill Murray, is like, you know, a professional comedy, you know, soft romantic comedy kind of version of it. I loved this premise. And I always love it, and I think that once a year we should get another people are repeating the same day over and over and over again so we can tell different genre stories.
But they did a clever thing too, is once you get it and that world feels familiar, they didn't spend an entire act having you watch the same thing with slight differences. It was like, you got it. Moving quickly ahead, you know, this is what it's, you know, jumping into him getting the competency and stuff was great. I thought that was just, that's how they made it feel fresh. So.
Yeah, and there's also just great, great, great storytelling elements that, without getting too much into it, you realize some characters know more than others at very interesting times. And that's what really, that's when it went from, hey, this is a clever movie, to, hey, this is a really good movie.
Yeah, the movie was ahead of you and didn't let the audience get too far ahead of the characters, which is frustrating when you're waiting for them to catch up. Justin, you have a pick?
Sure. My pick is, I'm trying to think if I have a better one. You want to know what? My pick is Silicon Valley. I really like the season premiere of Silicon Valley. And I feel like in that big block they have on HBO on Sundays now with Game of Thrones, that and Veep. I'm a huge fan of Veep, but Veep this season, at least the first episode, kind of felt a little tired to me. Silicon Valley is a show that I've always felt is kind of hit or miss when it's trying to nail down something. But I feel like they've got a kind of a confidence to this first episode, and I'm excited to see kind of where they go. I very much love that cast, and I'm excited to see what happens next.
I finally caught up, because I had so many people going, have you watched it? And I'm like, I watched the first season. The first episode of the second season was it was a little uneven for me, and it's one of these things where there's so many things to watch that and also that it was with the loss of was it Christopher Evan Welch, cast member who died after season one, and he was, you know, he was one of these, in watching his performances, wow, this guy's great, and it was there, and the cast was there, the writers were in a very difficult position. How do you deal with that? And they, you know, they have to write off Peter Gregory, but the weird way it became a joke, you know, like Peter Gregory's dead, and I was still kind of like, it was like when, you know, it was like Andy Whitfield from Spartacus when he died. You know, you're like, I don't know if I can watch the show because, you know, I like this guy. He seemed like a very charismatic person. And with this, it was sort of that first episode was sort of, it left me uneven. And understanding that what that cast and crew and writers went through, that loss that they went through, I couldn't even imagine what that was like for them. And they're trying to figure out how to deal with it. But that still being said, it was hard for me. But then I said, you know what? Everybody keeps talking about how much fun season two is, so I jumped into season two and loved it and thought it was great. So,
have you seen the first episode of season three?
Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm very excited to see where they go. Speaking of Groundhog Day, with Stephen Tobolowsky, who is someone that, even if you don't know his name, you have certainly seen him in so many awesome things and is hilarious in Groundhog Day. I feel like he fits so perfectly, and he has like a very a role that I think very much fits in his comedic skill set, as he kind of a lot of times sort of gets fit in as the bumbler or the buffoon, and here he plays this like crafty CEO who's been around Silicon Valley for a while and has a real track record and is just great at sort of softly manipulating people, and that is exactly where I like him as an actor. So I'm excited to see where they go.
Yeah, he's it's neat to see him in a bigger role like that. My pick is, I've only seen the first episode, so I can't vouch for the rest of the season. So if it's completely a disaster, I apologize. And I'm trying not to like binge watch it all at once. Daredevil season 2.
Oh.
Dude, I've only watched the first episode of Daredevil, and part of it is that, you know, I'm forbidden from watching it without Bonnie, and so and then all this amazing television started coming out. But I'm right with you, man. I enjoyed everything I'm seeing, except for I love the character Froggy. I don't think he or Foggy Froggy.
Foggy.
Yeah. His execution is just short of. It's the only weak spot I've seen so far.
I think he bothered me a lot in the first season. I think he does really good work in the second season as you unfold, and largely because they give him stuff to do beyond just be an idiot or a patsy or a comic relief, that he actually has the things he's going to work through. Daredevil season 2, like Game of Thrones, like House of Cards, it's a show that I'm sure there'll be a million people talking about why it's in decline or it hasn't done what it should. I can't not like a show that has, and I don't even want to mention the genre elements that it does so well for fear of spoiling anything for anyone, but just so confident in so many storytelling elements that I just have tremendous love for. And like, you know, it takes the Punisher seriously on a level that I don't feel any of the movie adaptations really got to, even though I've enjoyed some of the movie adaptations. It just is, it's so comic booky in the way that we've always wanted things to be comic booky, even more so than the MCU, where it's like these are great genre stories that they can tell with these familiar characters, and it's cool that they cross over. In episodic television done well with these characters, you need to just do a lot of really good comic book storytelling sort of elements to it. And this is a show that very much gets that right, just sort of weaving folks in and out and giving you these stories that you want and having just these great, 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 great moments.
I enjoy the fact that first episode that, you know, we had, for me, there's a good contrast because you had the first episode of Game of Thrones came on last week.
Yep.
And, you know, and I still love that show. I love that show. I mean, that show could be, you know, just Tyrion reading, you know, the Dornan, you know, phone book. And I'd totally be into it. But it was an interesting scene with Daredevil. They're like, hey, you know, this is about Daredevil and Punisher. Yeah, we're going to get right into this really quickly. You know, we're going to get this quickly and we're going to set up. Like, I like where Foggy's going. I think Deborah Ann Woolls, her Karen Page, I really dug what they're going with her. Like I said, she's, you know, realizing her in her own way. She's not just the really hot girl that works in the law firm that creates sexual tension. She's got her past and her things she's dealing with. I think she's a really strong character. I was interested to see how does she try to handle things. When they cut to Foggy, how is he going to resolve stuff? So I like the fact that a weakness in a show is when they cut away to another character and you're like, can we get done with that so we can get back to the story? And I think the strength of a show is when any side character, you're absolutely eager to see what's going to happen with them.
Yeah.
So. Daredevil. And yeah, and the fact that now we're getting a Punisher spinoff, which I guess, spoiler, he doesn't die in this season, so.
Yeah, I mean, there's certainly that in terms of the announcement. When it comes to binge watching, there's only so much you can protect from big gigantic spoilers. But I'm mega excited. I think it's gonna be great. I love what they're doing with Punisher, and they certainly give you all the toolkit for what a good Punisher should have in this series. I'm so pumped.
Gentlemen, we got some really cool stories people sent in, which we will address. We'll be using them later on. But if you send us your weird stories to Weird Things, we'd love to talk with them. So we thank you for the two ones we got, and we will try to do those. I think we'll lead with those next week. And please keep sending more of those. In the meantime, it's been weird.
Boom.
That is a fact. Let me.
Yeah, Bryce.
Let me double check that the kids are all good.
Mention the email at that, but we'll have it in the show notes. Email. How's it going, guys?
Good, buddy. How you doing?
Doing good. I'm doing good. Getting ready for San Francisco.
What's going on there?
Oh, you know.
Live Night Attack next Saturday.
Mm. Yeah. Mm. Is that still a thing?
It is. Wait, Bryce, did you say you were coming out, or?
Yeah, we made it work. So I will be coming into San Francisco on the day that Brian gets there, but not the same flight.
Cool.
By choice.
So awesome. That means I can loop you in with the venue, so you can help with that.
Yeah, that'd be great. I'll be sure to bring a camera and some recording stuff, and we'll do it upright.
Yeah, man.
How are you guys?
Dude, living the dream. For whatever reason, while we were talking, I had the desire to bring up, because we were joking about Armageddon, and I made the joke about J.J. Abrams, you know, like the writer of Armageddon will never go on to do anything.
Jonathan Hensley.
And so I brought up, I've never actually read the script for, but I kind of really want to read it now, J.J. Abrams' Superman script, his flyby script.
Yeah.
I'm excited to read it.
Well, remember, too, though, that, like, you know, like, he was one of many writers on Armageddon, you know?
Oh, yeah. No, I'm...
And he's been... I think he's made fun of Superman flyby, too, you know, of what...
Oh, I don't doubt it. I mean... it really, I only want to read it just because I'm curious about it. Like, I'm curious because it's certainly, for me, it was iconic.
Is this the script?
This is what I found.
It's it's linked from supermanhomepage.com if you just look up J.J. Abrams' Superman script. And we got the link in the chat there.
But this was the first thing that I knew of J.J. Abrams, was that he was reviled the internet wide for his script, his Superman script, flyby. And by reviled the internet wide, I mean, I read AnacleNews.com and the talkbacks was, you know, very aflame by this. But yeah, obviously, you know, he's come a long way, baby. In terms of fanboy reaction. I'm going to hit the bathroom. I'll be BRB.
So do we have an angle of what we want to do for after things?
We got two stories here, two questions, two things.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I'm going to use the restroom too, Brian. Try not to choke on all this air.
How are you doing, Brian?
Good. Yeah. Trying to figure out what the rest of my afternoon's going to go like. I guess we have to record some Scam School remixes. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you have to go and do stand-ups. I don't know how we are in the stand-ups department.
You might need to, I think, but I don't know. That'll be a brand thing. I think we might be good on that.
Yeah, because we're only two behind, right? We've only done two since we got caught up.
I don't think we got all the way caught up. I think we were two behind.
Oh,
when that last session was done, I think. I only glanced at the production guide since then. Right. But I thought there were a couple holes.
Do you have any suggestions which ones those were? Or?
I don't, because I don't know. And again, this could be Bryce being wrong. Where is all my stuff? But yeah, so you got Scam School Remix, and... I don't know if they ever sent that copy over for...
Yeah, they did.
Oh, they did? Okay.
Yeah, so we have that updated, the click it or ticket stuff.
Cool, yeah. Oh, no, we... Yeah, no, two. There are still two holes in the stand-ups.
For the two that we just shot, right?
No. Oh, sorry. Then there are two more. The Mike and Ike's one and the Eric's trick from Rusty Mule.
Wait, we didn't do that one?
Ugh. Okay. All right.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're okay. Good point. So we're four behind, which means I probably will have to go do stand-ups.
Oh, yikes.
Yikes. Are you feeling under the weather? Is this...
No, I'm not. Just, I mean, just allergies.
Allergies.
But mainly I'm just trying to figure out how to get everything done ahead of time so that I could be out all week without that being a giant disaster.
I think that'll be good. Yeah. We batten down the hatches.
So there's that. Yeah. I am sincerely pissed off, though, about, like, finally sitting down to play Firewatch. And just wasting my time because I walk into a bush. And then just like my experience is over because I'm stuck in a bush. And the only way to go is to restart that day. Just like, sorry, you walked into a bush and you're trapped in clipping. And you're just
there in a bush. There is checkpointing. If there should be checkpointing.
You could restart days.
Some of those long days.
Yeah.
Sorry.
No, I'm just saying.
It's a good game. I think you should give it.
I agree, but it's just like, you know.
You had one glitch.
That's fine, but it's a glitch that just did away with literally one half of my entire invested playthrough. And from what I understand, it's like a 4-hour game, right?
Yeah, about
so
that.
Basically, I just set fire to one of those 4 hours and I get to go through them again. And it won't be experiencing it again. It'll be me just trying to get from. Okay, yes, go scripted event or whatever. Like, whereas, like, I felt they did a really good job of telling the story and making me care about the interactions. And I know I won't be playing it. Like,
well,
unlike...
I get that. It's unfortunate. I mean, it really does suck when you have to redo anything, especially story heavy like that.
Yeah.
You only got an hour in, so I don't even know that you scratched the surface on.
And near the end of the second day. So
you really didn't get like you're getting into you're just if this was a dive here, let me put myself on screen. So like if this was a dive and you're here at the balance on the bounce board, right?
Right.
I feel like you just started the jump.
Okay.
I don't know.
But then my reward is to go back and start it again. I mean, again,
it's like the kind of thing where, like, I want to tell you that some really cool shit happens.
I believe it, I hope I ever get to see it. But we'll see. You got fish in there? Is that brine shrimp? What do you got?
So, a friend of mine, she gave me this, and I'm terrified. It's a entirely sealed ecosystem. So it's got in there. It's got water, a branch with algae, and then these shrimp, right?
Yeah.
That swim around, so you never feed it whatever, you just have to make sure there's enough light there for the algae to grow. I've never owned a pet. I mean, when I lived with my family, had pets. I've never had a pet. She gives this to me like, oh, you know, that way you have a pet. I'm like, ah. I mean, when I used goldfish, we may have you know, given away to people that maybe had dubious intentions with them, you know, for like magic. But now this responsibility has fallen upon my shoulders of these shrimp. And she's like, oh, you should name them. I'm like, I can't name them because when they die, I'm going to have something to mourn.
Hmm.
So, but it's actually was developed by NASA originally, was to see about creating an entire system. So you have the algae and then you have the shrimp. And then when the shrimp like shed their skeletons, there's microbes in there that feed off of that. And then the algae feeds off the nutrients and the light. So.
If this doesn't work out, I'll get you a Tamagotchi.
Probably be better. So
that's neat. It does feel scary to know that that whole system is sealed off. It's a lot of trust to put into the design.
Yeah.
All right, we ready for some after things?
Yeah, bossy.
It is true.
All right, well, take it away. In 3, 2.
Welcome to After Things. This is the podcast where we talk about being a creative, being a professional, taking your ideas and getting traction in reality. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Justin Robert Young.
Hello.
He says Coily and Brian Brushwood.
I bet you didn't see me just whip out a muddler that I'm shaking in your face. Don't make me shake the muddle stick.
What's a muddle stick for,
Muddler is what you do when you're making drinks and you want to mash a citrus fruit, right? This is the bartender 10-in-1 gizmo. So you can kind of do, and then you can, but it feels really good to take it.
Looks
and,
like a,
whip it
like this. Like a car stealing tool.
Too. It does, doesn't it? It looks like a, like a, I'm an
blackjack?
A late 1800s Irish copper, and I'm about to, you know, hit some drunks off the streets.
Yeah. Or perform some very painful medical test.
That's all of the above. All of the above.
Yeah, they were quite robust back then. So we're going to start right off. Now, we've told you guys, if you want to send us your questions, things you're working on, we'll be happy to try to give you our advice. And, you know, you know, regular listeners know enough about our resumes, how much credence to give what we tell you we think you should do. So all for informational purposes only. We're going to start right off. We actually had two really good questions that came in here for After Things. And I wondered if, Justin, do you have these in front of us? Do you want to use your wonderful voice to read these to us?
I can, yeah. Just give me two seconds.
We'll
bring them up.
Yeah. So if you have a question you want us to try to approach, you can send it to what email address?
Send it to me, neshcom@gmail.com, neshcom@gmail.
And he will make sure that it falls before our eyes and catches our attention. Mix the words catch and get, by the way. Gitches our attention.
Okay, so here we go. This first one is from Daniel for After Things consumption. This is the project, 100 days, 100 stories, 100 words, 100 photos. Inspired by Andrew's just write the damn thing attitude, I'm in the midst of writing of a writing project that was originally inspired by a camera app and brought to life by Andrew's writer walks. The backstory. Some years ago, I stumbled across a camera app by Trey Radcliffe, 100 cameras in one. This app, of course, had names for the different filters that you could apply to your lunch photo or bathroom selfie. When what caught my attention was the name of the filters. It was as if the names were phrases pulled from random stories. I was inspired to reverse engineer these and write the stories that these titles could come from. Being a novelist at heart, I tried to write too much to make the project happen. I wrote one story and was halfway through two other stories before I let having a fourth child, being an English teacher, cat videos, and YouTube cause me to do the, quote, I'll do this later, or put it in the I'll do this later pile. About a month ago, I was on a writer's walk, yakking into my iPhone and generally freaking out my neighbors. Thank you, Andrew. And something Brian said crashed headlong into the dormant project in the back of my head. If you want to accomplish something, you need measurable, achievable, and have a date of completion. I have done none of these requirements for my previous iterations. I now have 100 days to write 100 stories using only 100 words and take 100 photos. I am a photographer as well, and that will make sense in a moment. I'm publishing these stories on my website and Instagram. These photos make sense now. I then share the Instagram photos on Facebook. When this project is finished, I intend to publish them as an art book slash short story collection. The question, how do you get this project beyond the friends and family wall? It is fairly easy to get the follows and likes from those you already have in a relationship. But that only gets you so far, and their feedback can be suspect in its authenticity. I've shared the links in a Facebook group, Long Live the Tadpool, and it didn't seem to get much traction or notice in the cacophony of quick-moving timelines. I don't want to spam the group with postings for obvious reasons. I have considered buying ads on podcasts like The Morning Stream. I've also considered writing these stories and postcards. Flash fiction is sometimes called postcard fiction. And mailing these out and dropping them off in places like coffee shops, bookstores, or handing them out in colleges. I think these ideas have potential, and I don't want to waste time that could be used writing or working on other projects. Any feedback on the project itself or how to get it out to the wider world would be awesome. Here are the links to the project, danieljcollinsphoto.com/centum-fabulous or instagram.com/centum_fabulous. Somebody needs a shortener. Thanks in advance, Daniel J. Collins. You can find him on Twitter at Mooroy Jenkins, MOOROYJENKINS.
I'm reading between the lines here. I haven't seen any of the stories. I'm only just now seeing the photos. But it seems like your question is a little bit out of order from like your question is, how do I break out of the friends and family wall? And it assumes something that I don't believe is necessarily true. It assumes that the moment of creation needs to coincide with the moment of publication, and that the two of those need to be remotely close to one another. I don't think that's true at all. I think that, that you need to hone your craft, hone your skill, build up your content. You know, we've talked about on this program how Andrew Main is sitting on like 6 full-length novels that he's written, that he's waiting for the right moment to come out. I think it's a fine event to do 100 stories in 100 days with 100 photos using 100 filters. I think it's great that you're basing it on the work of someone else. Here's a nutty idea. This whole thing was created based on Trey Ratcliffe's names for his filters. Have you talked to Trey about it? Seems to me like if I'm somebody who has 100 cameras in one and somebody was doing a giant artistic product, a big endeavor, seems like I'd want to reach out to my massive, massive 4 million hardcore followers on Google Plus or whatever.
And if one of these podcast hosts decided to send a text message to Trey telling him that you were doing this.
Yeah. I mean, like, because, yeah. Getting,
I just
getting
did that,
Trey,
actually.
Yeah, getting to Trey is literally, like, it probably has already happened because you probably already sent the text.
I did. I sent the text to tell Trey's doing this. Yeah.
So it's like that's not the problem. To me, there are two elements here, and you are conflating them. Here's the first. You wanted to complete something. You wanted to set a goal. You wanted to go do something, and you wanted to complete it. That's your reward. That's your ability to do it. And you are doing it. Congratulations, you're doing it. But then later in the email, you're like, well, I want people to see it because they don't want it to be wasting time. And that if it doesn't get out to people, then that will be the failure. Well, already you're setting two different and oftentimes conflicting parameters for what succeeds and what fails. If you've set your thing and you're like, hey, I can write a 100 word story a day for 100 days. And I want to take a photo with each of them. Then awesome. That's great. Like that's a huge thing. And you should focus on every inch of that. And not let whether or not it's getting out to people necessarily be a thing, because right now this is, you should be hopeful that however far you get into it, you can continue to build an audience that wants to share it, and not necessarily worry about like whether or not people find the premise so interesting that they need to follow every element of it. Because I don't know how far do we know how far he is in.
It looks like he's about
nine posts in. Yeah.
9 days.
And you know, to be honest, man, like if it were me, for both goals, for the I don't want to, I want to be able to complete something goal, and the I want to tell people about a goal. A, it's a far more interesting project at 50 than 9. You know, it's a far more satisfying project for you that you've built a system for which you can continue to do it at 50 days as opposed to 9. I think that that's something that you need to, like, A, separate those two totally. Whether or not I can do it and whether or not people care about it are two different things. And then beyond that, like, figure out what the work is, you know? Then start telling people, and then, you know, hopefully you can communicate with Trey and say, hey, listen, I just want to let you know that I'm doing this. And then once you kind of get it to a point where A, when people want to see it, they can see more than nine things, then that will seem impressive. That will seem important. That will seem worthy of people's time, and they will want to see it come to an end. Because even if you hit people up at 75, you still have the far better part of a month that people are wrapped up in something. Like, that's impressive.
I think you get into the idea that when we want to get into something, we want to create, we want to do that. Part of the process, there's the idea of the process, and then there's the product. And as we've touched upon here, is that if your goal is the product, then you focus on the product, you just do these things, then you say, hey, I did 100 of these, check these things out. If your goal is the process because you want something to come out, you know, what is your goal out of the process? People to pay attention to what you're creating, people to say, hey, look at this person they're writing. You got to make damn sure that the process is not just, it's not just here's a cool idea what I'm doing, but people are really engaged and enjoying what they're doing. I have a lot of unpublished books that are never going to be published because they're not good. You know, that I had to write those to get to where I am now. And I still have books that I'll write something and be like, yeah, I like this personally, but I know that it's not going to connect or whatever. So I'm very hesitant to put I don't put 99% of my process in front of people. People see, I talk a lot about, I put this book and I did this and did that, but all the pages in between don't go out there. They're not there because it might be kind of interesting to people, but it's nowhere near as interesting as the finished work. When I started writing and putting stuff out there, I had long conversations with Justin about, I don't think I'm going to talk about the writing process, you know, initially. And I didn't. I didn't do a lot of talking about writing, being a writer, and what trying to do that. I wanted to talk about the books because I thought I wanted my work to speak for itself and not just the fact that, hey, you guys know me as this, but this is how I'm a writer. Now I feel more comfortable doing that because the books have had their own success and I can, you know, point to those. And then I can talk about my experience as a writer and still qualify. I'm a guy still trying to figure things out. This thing, you're doing a very public thing. It's great. It's absolutely great that you're doing, you know, 100 things, 100 days. I think those things, those kinds of concepts are great ideas. You know, I played around with stuff like that. And even like in 3D printing, well, let me create like a new thing every day, or let me do this. And that becomes a huge commitment. You follow through and you talk, you promote, you know, we'll tell Trey about it. Every time you do a post, you should tag Trey on, you know, Twitter and Instagram and say, you know, inspired by @TreyRadcliffe's blah, blah, blah. If we can't get his attention for you, that should get his attention for you, which can then help. And it brings interest to what Trey did with the 101 Cameras app. Keep at it. But yeah, don't make your goal to get attention at this point. Make your goal to work on your craft. And I'm not a believer that, like, oh, if you do great work, then people follow. There's a lot of wonderfully obscure things that people don't follow. But a really great thing, really great work with a lot of effort and attention does succeed.
I mean, people are, and some people in the chat room, like, what I'm not saying is just do good work and magically people get to you. I'm saying that they are two different muscles. Mm-hmm. And if you want to work on one, work on one. And when you are better and more confident on that muscle, it's easier and different to work on this totally other thing, which is promotion and getting stuff out there. And if right now you're worried about this and this is what you were initially looking to focus on, then focus on that. Then, like, draw a wall between whether or not, like, don't look at your view counts. Wait, you know, get it better and better and better, and then focus on the other end of it, because there are just two different processes.
Yeah, I think the most significant thing that I got out of what you were saying, Justin, is that the most interesting part of any marathon is the last mile. That's when you want to tune in and be like, it's happening. So it's like, yes, you have to go through 100 days and 100 short stories or whatever, but as you get closer, you can get louder saying, day 75, heads up, world, it's happening. Day 80, it's happening, world. Day 88 is when you start saying, by the way, you can get the book. You can pre-order right now. It's a beautiful coffee table book. Scored a deal with this publisher. You've seen what most of it is going to look like. You're going to love it. And it's got a giant twist coming up at the end. In the early, you know, just like Justin said, if you're doing it to get good, then just do it to get good. But realize that right now is not the time to be desperately worried about how loud and famous you're making.
Yeah, because it's an idea right now. You're nine posts and it's an idea, and you're trying to get everybody else invested in this idea, which, you know, it's neat. And it's as a personal goal, dude, hats off. I think that's fantastic you're doing that. But I've been a guy all my life. I have this idea. And people are like, well, that's great. Show up when you have it. Show up when it's delivered and show up when it's there. And you know, and even then, you know, how interesting will that be to people? And I think that if I were to say, hey, if you were to do this, you know, approach towards this is, I would make it a little more specific or something. I might be like, oh, I'm going to take sci-fi looking photos and do sci-fi looking things, or I'm going to do horror. I'm going to do 100 little short horror stories based on these things that I see, and give people sort of a hook to that. You know, or you could say your city. What's your city? Make it a part of wherever you live and say, yeah, I'm doing 100 photos and so-and-so, and I'm doing 100 stories set in the city. And that way, don't make it so sprawling and everything. There's a guy, you know, like I live in Los Angeles. Some guy's doing 100 photos a day of Los Angeles using these kind of cool filters as his inspiration, and he's doing 100 stories based upon those locations. Is somebody in Los Angeles? That's cool. Somebody outside of town? That's kind of an interesting thing. So give it that kind of hook to it, and I think it makes it more compelling than, hey, some guy's writing 100 stories and taking 100 photos a day. Guess what? That's called the internet. Everybody's doing that.
Can I also say, I'm sure that this isn't him. I'm sure that this is just me reading into it, and I'm sure that he is smarter than me, because this is a mistake that I have made a million times. He starts out by saying, I don't know if I can do this. I've often started things and not finished them because I let other things get in the way. So now I want to set this goal for myself. But then I want a bunch of people to see it. Now I know this is just me reading into it, and this is probably not it. But if he had the idea that he is more likely to do it if people were paying attention to it, or if he got attention on it, then I will be the one to say that is a terrible idea. That is having a baby to save a failing marriage. Like, the attention that you get on a project will be far better if you are confident in the project, or at least have an idea where to go. Because I'll let you know this. Attention is oftentimes just as negative as it is positive. That you want, that you crave attention because, hey, it means that I'm successful. It means there's validation. It also means that there's criticism. It also means that there's expectation. It means that if, for whatever reason, you have to go to the hospital for a day, now people are angry at you, right? I was just, during After Things, browsing my Facebook feed, and our friends Double Toasted, Corey and Martin, did a live show in Seattle last night. And apparently there was an issue with live streaming their show. And now Corey has to go on this huge defense thing because there are people that love them, that love their content so much that they were furious that there was no live stream of their live show the day that it happened, right? And that's attention, man. You want to think about what fans are? You want to think about what attention is? You want to think about what that brings to a project and how it affects it? It's a lot more than the fun stuff. And if you think that that will help a process that you are not confident on, I will almost universally guarantee it's more complicated at the very least than you think.
Yep, I agree with everything.
Gentlemen, we have another post. Another question.
We do. This one comes from Todd. Todd writes, hey, a question about promotion. Hello, weirdos. I'm striking out into unfamiliar territory and I need guidance. I've gotten alphageekmedia.com, where I believe this show is streaming, to a stable place in its development with a great group of more than 50 shows streaming live on the network each week. I now find myself needing to promote the network to a larger audience and find myself not even knowing where to begin. The goal, increase viewer listenership and traffic so the network can become a place where new audience members can discover the hosts and shows that appeal to their particular slice of geekdom. Thank you.
Man, that's a rough, said with all love and respect to Todd Whitehead. You can't, it's the equivalent of saying, how do I make this roll of duct tape go viral? It's like, you can't make anything go viral. All you could do is maximize the opportunity for something that already wants to go viral to do exactly that.
Hold on, right into Twitter, Brian lies about gaffer's tape, calling it duct tape going viral.
Okay, you're right. It is gaffer's tape. Touché. Okay, but you see, now we've added a narrative. We've made it more interesting. It has a better chance to go viral now. But it's a
I love this if Gaffgate went viral. It's just like now, like that one moment. It's just like a loose change style, like black and white. Like, but did he know that it was gaffer tape, or did he know that it was duct tape? If you look at his smile, it reveals a lot.
Is it truly a gaff? So here's the thing: is there's two things to consider. Number one. What you want to do is increase the amount of people using your service. And what your service is a fantastic clubhouse where people can see rad content. And you have a partnership with a number of different programs, including Weird Things and DTNS, Trekcast, the Geek All-Stars podcast, and so on. And you are proud of the clubhouse you've built. And now your question is, how do we get more people in? Well, if you're a club owner, one way you do is you book higher profile acts to come in, the kind of people who are going to bring in more people. You seek out those partnerships, and you make it happen that way. Or you build out, I mean, you run in a nightclub, Todd. Just think about it from now on. You book acts that perform on your stage, and those acts bring their audience. And there are two ways to get more people in. One is to book higher profile acts that bring their own audiences in. Number two is to offer amenities that make that club the most fascinating, most interesting place. This is why Twitch is tearing it up. There's a lot of different ways that you can live stream your media, but they have the fact that you have custom emotes. You have all of these things that make people identify with Twitch as their favorite place to be. I mean, basically, consider what has worked for them and figure out ways to implement that on your platform as well. Does that sound about right?
I would go into... So I'm aware that we're on Alpha Geek. I've spent minimal amount of time actually looking at that, and I think this may be the first time I've looked at, you know, the front page of Alpha Geek. And I first thing I get to the front page and I'm going like, I know what we're doing, I know what it does here. I look at this thing and I get this big square that's got eight things that say video one, video two, video three, and I'm like, what am I supposed to start switching this thing? First impression, it's a confusing first impression. I don't know what this is. I assume maybe I press these things to see shows. I don't know what I'm looking at. There's a news feed there that, as a first person here, that's not my primary interest. Your most attractive, most interesting thing is when I click on the shows tab and I look at live shows and I see, oh, this is what everything is. This is if you go below the screen and you scroll down, all these things, I go, oh, this is what this is, right? So I would focus on the idea of saying, what's your first thing and what should you be? And I think that you should think about grouping these things, because your best fan for a Weird Things, you know, somebody who's listened to Weird Things is probably going to be maybe interested in some of those other shows there, like, oh, you like weird and strange and sci-fi? Here are these things, because sometimes people want to put together blocks of that. You want tech? You know, here's Chord Killers. This looks like it's arranged alphabetically, which is certainly... makes it easy to figure out where in the alphabet each one of these should go. But if you're trying to grow within this network, you want to tell people what other content is there that fits those things. And so I would try grouping stuff by content, and I would think that front page, what does YouTube's front page do? It shows you this is what you can watch. Here are the videos, or here are these channels we recommend. Push that. Your front page is, you know, recommended, and you know, I would really, really try to revamp and make this a user-friendly site, you know, because I see video one, video two, video three. I know what those mean, but I don't know what those mean. I don't know, have no idea what those things are supposed to do for me. So make that thing, because you can, if we could send you 100 eyeballs to this page and 99 of them are going to click away in the next 2 seconds, you're better off sending 10 and having 5 people stick around, you know, and that's what you need to think about. Is so many times people misuse social media with very ineffectual messages. You know, they get in front of a platform and they think that, well, the content's there, they'll find it. And that's been a thing, man, since I worked with, you know, in the 90s, working on, like, you know, trying to help develop websites and stuff, where people are like, well, no, people can find it, that's there. Like, you're assuming they care enough to do that. You're assuming that they're going to spend the time to do it. And people don't. People will go where something else is much better at capturing our attention. So you've done a lot of hard work putting something really, really great here, you know, to bring the stuff together. Make it easier for people who are discovering things on here to find this other stuff. Put that up front. Figure out, like, when one show is playing, like, if I click on Weird Things, the video, and I get the thing is, and I hear my voice, is I would put in there, hey, you might also like these other things. Now, I see, you know, there's a couple things of the video channel 3. You maybe grouped it there, but, like, I would put these other descriptions of other shows down there. And it's hard, man. It's hard to try to figure out how to organize all this stuff together. I'm not saying it's an easy thing, but use people's attention, direct people's attention.
Here's one thing that I always know, or to me, I associate Alpha Geek Media with, is mobile streaming. When I want to listen to the morning stream when I was on the road, I would listen to it via Alpha Geek Radio. That is something that I always associated with it. And so, yet, although I knew that the service was ultimately being provided to me by Alpha Geek Radio, I did not use an Alpha Geek Radio solution to get there. I would go to the website and I would click on a link, and it was always kludgy, but it wasn't, there wasn't like an easy way that I could, you know, like let's say for any of the shows that we do, that we can just say, hey, if you're in your car, go here. You know, if you're on the go, go here. If you want to listen to us while we go live, you know, what we've created, you know, and this is, look, there's a million different ways to listen to it. There's a million different ways to get it. But how does that help? You know, ultimately, if you're going to rely on the people that are pushing it out for you, what's the easiest way to say, for us to say, hey, if you're live on the road, listen to it here.
Yeah, and I guess also it means keep in mind that you, by nature of being the clubhouse runner, have the opportunity to kind of, I don't want to say force, but you have an opportunity to foster cross-promotion on everything. You know, if you know somebody can't afford to pay for your bandwidth costs or whatever, you can say, hey, here's an agreement. It's a legally binding agreement that we will host your stuff. We'll do X, Y, or Z. All you have to do is at the beginning and end of each show, make sure to plug Alpha Geek Radio or whatever. Like that kind of stuff puts a little bit of muscle in there because you're providing a lot of value. And if you're not getting, if you're doing all the work and not getting anything out of it, it seems like you could rethink your relationship with some of the programs.
Yeah, I don't know if this got brought up. Maybe that's what we're talking about right now in the comments. Like when I go to it on my mobile device, something's broken. And man, and like, listen, I will be the first one to tell you how hard it is to maintain stuff you put online after a couple months or whatever to keep things up to date and all that. It's a challenge. It is really, really a challenge, but there's nothing on my iPhone. I get a blank screen when I go to Alpha Geek, which I'm sure there's probably some app or something that's supposed to do that. And, you know, you're trying to do the work of people who are much more better funded and have more people to do it and can be done, but it's hard. But make it sticky. Make it usability is one of the clarity and usability make things sticky. If I know what this is, I know I want it. And if I can use it, I'm going to use it and stick around and tell people where to go with that.
Listen, and this is part of a pivot for Todd. Todd makes clear in the email, and I know that we've talked in the past that, you know, most of what he has focused on and made it extraordinarily easy for dunderheads like me to get on his service is creator focused. Here's how you get on the platform. Here's how you stream stuff when you're not streaming stuff, like, or not tagging it the correct way. Like I have a million different times. He's good at following up and saying, hey, by the way, here are like the three buttons that you have to hit. If you please do that. And I'm like, cool. He's great and patient and amazing with all of that. However, now you're focusing on the flip side. Now this is on new people coming in to listen to the shows that you've created. And that is a different, it's a whole different world, you know, and that requires different solutions. Cause what I see when I go to Alpha Geek Media right now is a site that is very, very creator focused, but not, might not be particularly user focused.
And keep in mind, like this is not an unusual debate to be had. There is a certain elitism, and I mean this with all love and respect, among a certain brand of geeks who love the more functional something is, the better it is. You know, for example, if you go to cordkillers.com, Tom loves the austereness of the website. Makes me nuts that we're looking at that a Times New Roman font on a white background. But, you know, it's to each their own.
Yeah, if you know, there's the content there where you need it to be, whatever. And Todd, you do a wonderful job of communicating with people and hosts and everything like that. And Justin pointed out, you do a great job of communicating, which is, that's hard. That's hard. And what you're trying to do is a challenge. And so the hardest part is when you do something that's competent and you're in front of people, you know, and we talked about before is, you know, that like with the last question is that when you don't live up to somebody's expectations, what you want to do, even though they're not contributing anything to it, you know, you get people let you know. And, you know, we're here like, well, it needs to be this, it needs to be that, da, 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 da. But, you know, don't, we're all in admiration of what you're doing, what you're putting together. Let me make that very, very clear.
So. Yep.
Let me also make it very clear that Todd personally was the only reason why I got my computer working. Todd went on a 48-hour personal mission of mercy for my entire tech system and fixed any and all of it. And in the process, wound up eliminating a redundant piece of technology that wound up screwing up stuff after we had fixed it. So not only fixed my computer, but made my entire system better. Todd is a living saint. So let me just make that clear in terms of my personal views of Todd Whitehead.
That is awesome.
Gentlemen, it's been after. Unless you want to do picks. You guys got picks?
Game of Thrones. We all agree it's Game of Thrones. It's been after.
Game of Thrones?
Game of Thrones.
Game of Thrones.
All right.
I always feel horrible when people are like, hey, here's my idea, my dream. And we're like, no, no.
Well, you want to know what? I mean, I think the biggest thing that I've learned in terms of constructive criticism is always being cognizant of where they are in their idea. Because, like, the advice that I've always found the most frustrating is the, like, is that your idea? Scrap that entire idea and do this other idea.
Yeah.
Like, instead of like, okay, well, here's how you finish your idea. And then when you go forward, here are some ideas once you've learned the lessons that you've learned on this idea that you can do. And that's why it's like, listen, for the first one, do that 100 things and just knock it out of your mind who's watching until day 75, you know, or day 50, day 60, whatever. You know, like that's what you go ahead and do. For Todd, I think it's as simple as like, hey, look, if this is where you want to go, then understand that, like, you know, you have done everything you can in wrangling creators into creating a fun space. Now make that listenable, make that watchable, make that something where it's like every day, you know, you can every week you have somebody saying like, oh, great, I was listening while I was in my car and it was easier to do because of an awesome AGR or AGM, whatever you want to call it, solution.
You know, and there's also like if you were a traditional company distribution method, like let's say you ran a radio station and you said, okay, we're going to fill up all the slots with all the programs and everyone's going to provide this stuff. Congratulations, you're all on my radio networks. You know what they would do is they would have something built in to where as you listen to it, they do station identification and they remind you that, you know, NPR is brought to you by listeners like you, and that's why you're able to listen to Marketplace. And now let's get back to Marketplace. I mean, if you're looking to get the word out to have more people experience it, then figure out a way structurally to make that part of the network branded experience.
I would say, side note, everybody's been super cool when we've been like, well, blah, 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 blah. Everybody's been very grateful, which is cool, which is good. But I always feel like, you know, like Simon Cowell.
Or these dicks.
Gooey.
Gooey.
I had a weird similar thing the other night. I've had people send me like beta versions of their games, and I'll play them on stream. And so you have to very actively be aware of that person and where they're coming from and their passion and intensity for this thing, which is tough, especially for video games, because you are always comparing it to these multi-million-dollar projects compared to this one dude who got, you know, 4,000 euros on Kickstarter.
Mm-hmm.
Bryce, the thought that I could create a pseudonym and send you a video game and you not know that it's from me, and having like Game Salad and other apps in my presence, I cannot tell you. Lucky for you, I have a book I have to finish and some other projects under deadline, or else you would find yourself like wait, what are these things flying at my face? You know, and I like some, I'd be like, I'd use some Japanese kid name or something like that. Then all of a sudden I would be the final boss.
That would be an amazing, oh my God.
If you
about it. Now you have to wait until I've like gotten past the paranoia stage into forgetting about the idea.
Every game now, you're gonna be thinking about that. I just think that would be, because we start off something so simple and something nine, you'd be like, wait, was that genitalia that just whizzed by?
Granted, maybe that's not uncommon on my stream. That was the games I played. Oh my gosh.
Good discussions, gang. That was fun.
Yeah, we should do this often, guys.
Yeah, you know, I think this is a good show, you know. I think it's just a real great time.
All right. Good night, everybody. We'll see you around.
I'll be back on Diamond Club in 30 minutes for the wrestling.